David Hubel grew up in Canada with an avid interest in science due to the influence of his father, who was a chemical engineer. He attended medical school at McGill University. In 1954, he moved to the United States and attended 2 years of specialized residency in neurology at the Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine. This is where he developed an interest in the nervous system. He was then drafted by the Army into the Walter Reed Army Institute of Research. There he began recording from the primary visual cortex of sleeping and awake cats. In 1958, he moved back to Johns Hopkins, where he began working under Stephen Kufler, the father of modern neuroscience.
Tortsen Wiesel grew up in Sweden and attended the Karolinska Institute, where he received his medical degree in 1954. In 1955, he moved to the United States to work at Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine, also under Stephen Kufler. This is where he met David Hubel, and their 25-year-long research collaboration began. Before Hubel and Wiesel began collaborating and won the Nobel Prize in 1981 for the research of neural mechanisms of vision, a lot was already known about the brain and visual perception. Scientists such as Helmholtz, Wundt, and Fechner originated the study of visual perception from a psychological perspective. Helmholtz's theory of color vision system gave way to Hubel and Wiesel's research.
Hubel and Wiesel received the Nobel Prize for two major contributions. Firstly, their work on development of the visual system, which involved a description of ocular dominance columns in the 1960s and 1970s. Secondly, their work establishing a foundation for visual neurophysiology, describing how signals from the eye are processed by the brain to generate edge detectors, motion detectors, stereoscopic depth detectors, and color detectors, building blocks of the visual scene.
However, Hubel and Wiesel didn't start out with clear-cut results and meticulous recordings. Rather, their initial discovery was the result of pure luck. Working in a tiny basement laboratory at Johns Hopkins, Hubel and Wiesel struggled to find any neuronal activity in a cat's brain that correlated with images of dark and light spots. Becoming increasingly frustrated, they waved their arms, jumped around, and even displayed images of glamorous women from magazines. Alas, nothing. Then, as they shifted the slide in the ophthalmoscope, they heard a cell in the cat's visual cortex fire. The edge of the slide had cast a faint, straight, narrow line on the cat's retina. They studied the cell for 9 hours and then ran down the hall screaming with joy. They studied this finding by inserting a microelectrode into the primary visual cortex of an anesthesiized cat. They found that some neurons fired rapidly when presented with lines at one angle, while others responded best to another angle. Some of these neurons responded to light patterns and dark patterns differently. Hubel and Wiesel called these neurons simple cells. Still other neurons, which they termed complex cells, detected edges regardless of where they were placed in the receptive field of the neuron and could preferentially detect motion in certain directions. This study shows how the visual system constructs complex representations of visual information from simple stimulus features. Their findings also indicated that the visual cortical neurons were indeed encoding features of retinal images, and therefore, the properties of the objects in the real world.
Another one of their experiments showed that if a kitten is deprived of normal visual experience during a critical period at the start of its life, the circuitry of neurons in its visual cortex is irreversibly altered. In each of a number of newborn kittens, one eyelid was sutured shut. The kitten was allowed to grow up that way, and when it reached adulthood, around 6 months, its eyelid was open again. Recordings were then made of the electrophysiological activity in each of the kitten's eyes. These recordings showed an abnormally low number of neurons reacting in the eye that had been sutured shut, and an abnormally high number in the other eye. Macroscopic observation of the visual cortex showed that the ocular dominance columns for the eye that had been left open had grown larger, while those for the eye that had been closed had shrunk. Later experiments showed that suturing a cat's eye shut had no effect on its visual cortex, unless this visual deprivation took place during the first 3 months of the cat's life. During the critical period, the two eyes compete with each other to dominate cortical neurons. If both eyes have equal retinal image, then most of the cortical neurons becomes binocular. When one eye wins out in competition, this is the result of ocular dominance. This has important implications for the understanding and treatment of deprivation amblyopia, also known as lazy eye, strabismus, also known as cross-eyed, and childhood cataracts. The experiment was also important for the study of cortical plasticity. This study suggests that what we are encountering today and how we perceive the world depends greatly on our sensory perception during our early years of development.
While Hubel and Wiesel received little to no coverage in newspapers, their research made way into many journals and had a huge impact on the field of neuroscience. They were two of the first to show how the firing of neurons and their organization can explain our real-life experience of the world.
Our collaboration, our experiments were long, took many hours, and were somewhat repetitive, and it gave us a lot of chance to discuss things. So we would talk and talk and discuss from morning to night, sort of to fill in the time. We both had an interest in music, although sort of a different kind of music, and I was more based in the classics, and Tortsen perhaps more eclectic. His interests were more in social things, in world affairs, and that sort of thing, in which I had very, very much less interest, although always some. Both of us read a lot, and so there were major common interests, but I suppose the science was the main thing that we were interested in. Not only the science in the sense of the technicalities or the hard science itself, but the social aspect of the science, you know, who we regarded as an idiot and who we regarded as very impressive and all of that. And all of that we almost always agreed on right away, almost from the first minute. So it's strange. And so we sort of had mutual understanding about what our outlook was on every subject, including science. But in science, our outlooks were very similar. And when people wrote papers, receptive fields weren't exactly circular, they were slightly elliptical. We thought that was hilarious. These people didn't realize that they were working with biology, after all. And so why should anybody think that things should be perfectly circular and think that was cause to write papers and that sort of thing? That kind of thing, we seem to see eye to eye on, and still we haven't worked together now for the last 10 years or so, and still when we meet it only takes 2 minutes before we're in the old former mode of not having to finish one sentence, the other person will know what you mean, and not having to elaborate on the one's way of thinking about things, because you understand.